Hello, I'm Barry Gander. I'm with iValley, and I thank you for joining me for this talk about intelligent communities, or smart cities, or intelligent cities. Many, many different words used to describe that. I'm actually guilty of writing many of those words, so don't hold that against me. But in fact, you don't need a lot of words when you're talking about smart cities. They are something that evolves but takes effort to put into shape. First, what are the smart cities that we're talking about here? They are ones that transform themselves through the use of information technology focused on a problem. And let me emphasize that it's not the technology itself. It's the use of the technology that is important. And that's what matters to these people. It's the reason why 9 out of 10 mayors would like to have intelligent cities in their neighborhoods and in their plans. Smart cities are places or online communities. They can be big or small. They can be rural or urban. It doesn't matter what the scale is. What matters is the goal and your harnessing of technology to reach that goal. They are at the center of global growth. They are where innovation happens. And innovation, of course, is driving the economy these days. And innovation happens in communities of any size. So if you're a rural community and you can make yourself smart, you have a very good chance of being a driver of innovation and being a contributing member of the global community and a rewarded member of the global community. Now, traditional cities are collections. They're collections of buildings, of geographic areas, of neighborhoods, and collections of problems. And governments are organized into groups that address single problems, each of these individual problems. It's like a bunch of random pearls rolling around on a plate. In a smart community, the pearls are linked together to form a necklace. A smart community is a necklace of sharing pearls that work together, becoming something new. If you think of a community this way, then what you want to do is tap into all of the resources and release the full potential of the community. New York, for example, has roughly 8.4 million people. Its civil service to cover that is 300,000 people. Now, there's no way 300,000 people can marshal the power of 8.4 million. But what they can do is enable these people to energize themselves and drive this wealth of lawyers and doctors and architects to tap into their expertise in support of the city. And that kind of new power is vital today because we are at a crossroads. We have, of course, the COVID pandemic, which is driving people online, much of them ahead of their time, that they would not prefer to do that. There's also problems with the environment, with global growth. We definitely need a new model to help our children understand this world and live on it. We have to get all of these interconnected systems working. And that was a thing that was not conceivable before. So what are the other benefits that you would get in a specific sense out of a smart city? Well, smart communities or cities have demonstrated that they can create high-value jobs, they create higher value to real estate, they can improve revenue streams or tap into new revenue streams, they can attract talent, they improve services, they accelerate innovation, and they manage social and environmental impacts. And looming over all of these reasons is the threat of competition. With today's global economy, each community is a global community. Each week, global competition for growth expands by 1.5 million people each week. That's a city the size of Philadelphia joining the global competitive urban environment each week. It's a smart city and can jump into that as a partner with that or be a valued player with those new communities that come in. The attraction for this, it doesn't have to be limited to size. It can be a small place that can pull a global ranking. Our own group put a small valley near us of 150,000 people onto the world stage by making it into the world's first smart rural region. And that vaulted it into the global radar. So let's talk about the steps to get there. I'm just going to borrow my book again for a second and use it as a prop. This is the low technology I was talking about. The first stage here is infrastructure, and nothing else happens until that's in place. It requires a fiber backbone, and that fiber backbone can hang all kinds of wireless networks off it, but that has to be the future-proof main spine of the smart city. In Chattanooga, for example, the city's city-owned electrical utility was running fiber to the houses to measure electrical inputs and come up with an energy plan. And they found that, lo and behold, they were able to create a fiber network for the people in the houses that they were serving. So they put in a system that is now one of the fastest in the U.S., and its smart power grid handles fuel consumption and carbon offsets in at the same time. So they've attracted new businesses. They've been able to feed smaller businesses that are offline, all by putting in something that was not originally intended. And the same thing can be done in rural areas. In the UK, there's a backbone system that was installed by an organization called the Broadband for Rural Network organization. It's a not-for-profit, and it created the world's fastest rural broadband network, 1G to every home, for about $40 a month. And just above that, when you're finished putting in your infrastructure, there is the collaboration stream. And that level addresses the levels of community involvement and how all the various elements work together. Singapore's Intelligent Island, for example, its concept positions it as a digital age trading hub, echoing its leadership role as a trading port for physical goods. Singapore is becoming a center for digital content, from web movies to online games. And that collaboration change doesn't need to be rocket science for it to be effective. Each year, millions of Americans, for example, fail to appear in court for low-level offenses, and arrest warrants are issued. Well, New York sent out text message reminders and a redesigned summons form and reduced their failure to appear by about 20%, which translates to 10,000 fewer arrest warrants each year. That's a big saving to the city. Now, above this stage in a smart city's life, there is the solutions stage. That comes next. And in the solution step, that's the online service step, the e-services for access to government, for government programs, for business development, and for education, health, and culture. Stockholm's website, for example, provides a huge range of applications through which citizens can request and receive service online, from applying for social housing to school portals for students and teachers. Renters in the city use that departmental portal to find apartments, and the library portal provides access to dozens of libraries. Now, at the top of all of this is the section called Life, and pardon the very short acronym there, but it captures the quality of living and working in the community, including safety and social cohesion. London, England, for example, took 100 different analytical views of the city and put them into maps. You can see different views based on marital status, age distribution. You can see where people are moving to in their various stages of their lives. In addition, of course, the buses and trains and subways are all there as well, so you can see where you're actually going. Now, when all of that is said and done, and you've got these levels lined up in your mind, how do you get there? Let's take a look at some of the cities and how they did get there. Riverside, California was challenged by land-intensive, low-technology businesses and a relatively low number of residents with college degrees. It formed a technology park with an incubator to foster startups. It provided a single point of contact within local government to attract and retain high-tech companies. It expanded fiber coverage and made Wi-Fi available throughout the city under a technology master plan. Now, Seoul, South Korea supported broadband services for its agencies, schools, and universities by offering loans to carriers for infrastructure construction. Today, there are more than 70 ISPs operating in Seoul, and they provide low access, or competitive, low-price access to the network, as well as still generating billions of dollars to the economy. Matika in Japan was threatened by the move of high-tech manufacturing to lower-cost sites. It developed a social culture that prized technology and considered R&D of high importance. It was the first city in Japan to field test fiber optic cable to the home, and the first ISP in Japan to offer broadband. And all of that brought citizenship participation in the development of its infrastructure. And lastly, I'd like to mention Taipei and Taiwan that challenged itself to become a cyber city, focusing first on building broadband infrastructure and using the internet for public service improvement. Now, most of the city's document traffic moves through its electronic document exchange. Its internet portal offers hundreds of services to thousands of citizens every day. These award-winning global smart communities have a pathway in common. They move to establish a governance structure, tap into the vision of each of its sectors, create a network for their coordination that was custom designed by their community, and their reward, and of course yours, is a community that is a world best place to live and do business. And let me emphasize again that today there is no choice. Around the world, other cities are exploiting the value of linkages as the driver of innovation and smart communities. They are designing movements so powerful that they often transcend national boundaries. I would urge you, as I'm closing this, to tap into the expertise of the Intelligent Community Forum in New York and the World Council on City Data in Toronto. If you need help doing that, we'd also, of course, be happy to chip in. Please get to me through Corning or directly. And at the time you're doing that, I think that you'll be ready to seize the moment to step up to a future that is yours. Cheers, thank you again, and thank you for listening.